Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Hospitality Law Conference 2023 in Houston, Texas. We hope everybody's travel travails were not as bad as some. Steve Abbott is in the house. Wow, it's great to see everybody. It's feeling good again, isn't it? Say yes. Okay, I'm happy to hear that. Well, welcome to Houston, Texas. My name is Stephen Barth, founder of HospitalityLawyer.com, professor at the University of Houston at the Hilton College. We call it the Hilton College because the Hilton Foundation has given us about $80 million over the last 60 years. If anybody else wants to write us a check for $80 million, we'll put your name on the building too. Just so you know, it's just an offer. We'll hold it open for a while. Breakfast this morning was supported by Ethics Suite. Let's say thank you to Juliette, Gust, and Ethics Suite. And thank you to the Le Meridian, the Houston downtown. I hope everybody's room's nice. Food and beverage has been great. I do want to go through a couple of things right now about the hotel. First, there is not a fire drill scheduled today or tomorrow. So if there is a fire alarm that goes off, it's the real deal. Everybody aware of that? And I got my global safety guru right here to lead the charge. But there, to your left, if you're facing forward, to the left of the screen where you see the door that goes out, there is a stairwell right there that will take you out. There's also a stairwell out through these doors that will take you down. The elevators will not be functional. Okay? If anybody's concerned about COVID, we have masks at the registration desk for you if you'd like that. Although last year I mentioned that and I was the only person that wore a mask ever. So, okay. But we have them if you'd like them. All right. So want to remind everybody, we do a lot in the social sphere. So they're there for you and the hashtags for you. And on your tables, there's a QR code that you can find the agenda located. The Wi-Fi is also there. There is not a password. The hotel tells me it's secure. I'll leave that to you. Yeah, I think public Wi-Fi has gotten more secure, I think. We'll find out. All right, so for CLE, those of you interested in CLE, the state of Texas has already approved it, 8.5 hours plus a half hour of ethics, thanks to Kendall Kelly Hayden. And but all the other states typically reciprocate with Texas, and so we're happy to help facilitate your application for the CLE when the time is right for you. At the end of each presentation today, a QR code will pop up on the screen. It just will have two questions on it about that presentation. So we would appreciate it if you would do the survey contemporaneously this conference, and we're going to remind you this is what it will look like. And when you open that QR code, or you can go to that URL down at the bottom and plug in that code. Once you do, you're in, and then this question will pop up and you can respond to it, and then there'll be a second question. So Our day today is going to start out with you down with OPP, ethics and restrictive covenants. There's a whole lot going on in this space right now, and we have Kendall Kelly Hayden going to present to you on that topic, always a favorite. Following Kendall, we're going to do three TED Talk styles presentations and Q&A with Juliette Gust, Jordan Schwartz, and David Denney joining us this morning. Then we'll take a networking break, come back for a few more TED Talks with Courtney Leis, Cliff Risman, and Seth. I'm sorry, Seth. Crumrich. I did. Thank you. I promise I practiced that. I know it didn't show. And we've got our award luncheon today. We're very honored to have with us Miss Andrea Ryan, who's our award recipient this year. Let's go ahead and get started and say congratulations, Andrea. And then after lunch, we'll come back with Elizabeth DeConti, Marissa Rauchway, as well as Samuel Newbold. And then we're going to keep going this afternoon with Raja Patil, Michael McGee, Robert Bernstein, and then Kendall is going to wrap us up again with her security topic. And then we're going, you guys, everybody take just a moment, just take 2 seconds and think about sunshine at 5 o'clock. Everybody just put that out there, okay? There you go, a little sunshine. But we're going to go up to the deck and have a nice little cocktail reception pre-dinner for those of you that have dinner plans. We'll have you out, but it's a nice view, hopefully, if the clouds stay away. We'll see how we go. But our conference is supported by all of these folks, and we just want to say thank you very much to all of them. You have choices when you reach out to legal expertise and thought leaders in the hospitality law industry, and we'll hope you'll reach out to these attorneys who have proven time and time again to be not just resourceful, but also experts in their space. Wi-Fi you've got, right? Just leave it up for 1 second, Momo, in case anybody needs it. Again, there's no password. And off we go. You like how that changed from red to green? Who noticed that?
Thank you.
Oh, okay. So, now we're going to talk about ethics. Y'all down with OPP, Ethics and Restrictive Covenants. Sharing her insight today is Kendall Kelly Hayden, a member of Cozen O'Connor in the Dallas office. Kendall is a commercial litigator. She emphasizes her practice in transportation, hospitality, as well as sexual assault cases in the employment context. I'll let you read that second bullet yourself. We're always happy to have Kendall with us. She's a hoot, as you're getting ready to find out. Please welcome Kendall Kelly Hayden.
So good morning. Stephen gave me the honor of speaking first and last. So while you're thinking about the sunshine at 5 p.m., don't think about it at 4:30 p.m. because if you think this is fun this morning, I'm going to try to make ethics as exciting as I can. My negligent security presentation will be even more fun. So I'm going to see if I can do, Marilyn, I don't know if I can, I'm trying to start my presentation with a little bit of volume, but I don't think I did it the right way. Hang on. Haley, are you able to press? Oh, here we go. Just to get us started this morning, raise your hand if you've never heard of Naughty by Nature. Okay, some millennials in our room, some baby boomers. So when Stephen asked me to talk about restrictive covenants and the ethics involved with those, I started researching it and reading a little bit more about it. My firm has done several webinars on this topic, so if you don't get enough this morning, you can go to my firm's website. There are plenty of podcasts on this topic. But one of the things I found out is the term human capital. And does anybody know what that phrase means? And let me tell you, because y'all are so excited to volunteer, I can tell, if you volunteer during my presentations, I will give you swag. And normally what I do is I bring Starbucks cards. But this year I decided to be a little bit more creative. The guests that I have sitting with me at my table are from Raising Cane's, Southwest Airlines. My client who's not here is Troon Golf, and we also have La Madeline. So I have swag from them, which is much more exciting than what I previously have given away. So let me just entice you to volunteer. I've got some La Madeline coffee. Thank you very much, Jean. I've got some Southwest Airlines luggage tags. Thank you very much, Lauren. I also have a Southwest Airlines ruler. You never know when you need a ruler. I have a Southwest Airlines pen in case you forgot a writing utensil. From Raising Cane's, thank you very much, Brian. I have an Enjoy a Box combo on us, and I have lots of these. That's really maybe the hottest item up here, except for the Cozen O'Connor phone and screen sanitizer. I know you need one of those. And also something if you need to clean off your glasses when you're going up to the rooftop later, we have a screen cleaner. So the one item that I only have one of is Lauren provided me a keychain with an airplane on it from Southwest. So again, please volunteer. I have people that will pass out the information to you and the swag item. So again, anybody want to guess what human capital is, or if you know what it is, feel free to shout it out. Okay.
Your workforce, employees, independent contractors.
I'm sorry, what did you say?
Your workforce, people.
Yes.
Your employees.
What is your name?
Raja,
thank you. That's exactly right. Raja, you are welcome to pick whatever you'd like. You just tell us what you'd like and somebody will bring it to you.
Raising Cane's.
Okay. See, I told you, hot item. So human capital is essentially what I'm referring to today as other people's property. It is the intelligence, the intellect, the skills that somebody in your workplace has and leaves with. And so keep that in mind when we're talking about the ethics of non-disclosure agreements and non-competes. The first topic is gonna be non-competes. These are some of the terms that we're gonna talk about during our presentation. For those of you who are not labor and employment people, the two agencies we're gonna discuss today are both the Federal Trade Commission, that's gonna be first, and the second is the NLRB. We're gonna discuss two decisions that have come out from each of those agencies just this year and the implications that those decisions will have on some of these human capital agreements, non-disclosures, non-disparagement agreements, confidentiality agreements, and non-competes. So by way of background, non-competes are generally disfavored. Those of you who have worked in this, this area know this. In some states, they're outlawed. The states that do allow non-competes, this is before the decision that I'm about to discuss, generally require three things. If you don't remember anything today from my presentation this morning, remember that generally if you narrowly tailor something, you're gonna be better off than when you broadly draft something. So these are some of the traditionally accepted justifications for non-competes. They must be reasonable. They also have to have a temporal parameter, meaning you can't just ask somebody not to compete with you for the rest of their life. So President Biden issued an executive order in 2021 basically promoting the non-competition in the workforce. And then in 2022, in November, the FTC sort of reiterated that and basically reminded everybody that their job is to prohibit unfair competition in the workplace. This is the first time in history this has happened. On January 5th, which I will talk about second, the FTC proposed a rule. But on January 4th, for the first time ever, the FTC brought three charges against various employers who had non-competes. And one of the examples I'll give you is one of the non-competes that they found to be in violation of the law involved security guards. This afternoon, I'm gonna be talking about negligent security claims. So I will tie this in with that presentation. Basically, the FTC said, you cannot ask security guards to not compete by prohibiting them to work within a 100-mile radius of the current workplace. Not only that, but the FTC said the penalties for them violating that provision were too steep. And I'm sorry, I have such a loud voice, I didn't realize I wasn't actually talking into the microphone. On January 5th, 2023, the FTC released a notice of a proposed rulemaking, or NPRM, to basically prohibit employers from engaging or offering non-compete agreements. And so, let me kind of go through some of the definitions that are in the actual rule. The basic takeaway, as I said, these are very broad. So I'm telling you to narrowly tailor your future non-compete agreements, but the FTC is doing the exact opposite. These are extremely broad definitions, that essentially encompass a lot more than you would think. So the definition of a worker encompasses an independent contractor. So in the rule, these are also definitions as part of the rule. The definition of a non-compete, again, it's broad. A contractual term between an employer and a worker that prevents the worker from seeking or accepting employment after the conclusion of the worker's employment with the employer. And then a de facto non-compete, does anybody want to guess what a de facto non-compete is without reading my slide? Remember, I have lots of swag. A de facto non-compete, if you look at the terminology, that's why I have both definitions up there, they're essentially the same. The only difference is that a de facto non-compete is not called a non-compete, but it has the same effect as a non-compete. So an example would be a very broad non-disclosure provision or a non-disparagement provision that also prohibits the worker from competing. So what I'm saying is you can have a violation of the FTC's proposed rule. And by the way, this is a proposed rule. It's not a final rule yet, so you can't be out of compliance yet. But you can have a de facto non-compete and be in violation of the proposed rule once it becomes final. So this is the rule itself. Basically, they are defining for you an unfair method of competition is when you enter in a non-compete clause. And so this has drastically changed decades and decades of law in state courts across the United States. And part of the issue with this is that before this promulgated rule, the rules that were out there in the state courts were very piecemeal because, of course, they were across different jurisdictions on a case-by-case basis in various states across the United States. And now the FTC has basically blanketly said, you may not have a non-compete agreement, and they'll explain to you why. So it's basically the second letter B also applies to existing non-competes. So if you, once this rule becomes final, have a non-compete that you issue to a former employee, that non-compete also has to be rescinded. So this applies to prior entered into non-compete agreements and current non-compete agreements. It does also say it is preempting all of the other laws that the United States of America and all the jurisdictions have decided on this issue before this rule. So what do you do if you want to rescind your pre-existing non-competes? How do you do it? Well, you have to provide notice to your, not only your current employees, but your former employees. And the rule actually says, if you have a former employee's contact information, you must contact them and provide this notice. I will show you, and you're welcome to cut and paste it from my slide, it's also in my paper, the language that the FTC has provided as model language to do this. This is the language. Again, I would recommend cutting and pasting it. You don't have to use this language, you can use your own language, but this is the actual language. These are exceptions to the proposed rule. Basically, if you're not governed by the FTC, for example, banks, then you're not going to be subject to this rule. There's other organizations like the Packers and Stockyards Act of 1921, which I did have to look up, even though I graduated from Texas A&M, I did not know what that was. And essentially, it regulates people in the meatpacking industry, the swine contractors from engaging in unfair trade and competition. For the people in this room who are involved in franchise situations, the rule does not apply to franchise agreements between the franchisor and the franchisee. It does, however, apply to the franchisee. So the guy that owns the Raising Cane's franchise down the street, he may not ask his former employees or current employees to enter into a non-compete agreement. The FTC opened up the public to comment on their proposed rule. It has since closed. It closed in April. These are the different types of commentary they requested feedback on. For example, basically the intent behind this rule is to understand that some people have unequal bargaining power. So the guy who's working down the street, perhaps at Raising Cane's, and who is at the fry cashier, may have a different bargaining power than somebody sitting in the corporate office. So the FTC is asked, should there be different rules for different classes of workers? And you can read the rest of that. There's also owners who have a 25% ownership in their company. They are exempt from this rule. But what about people who have a lot invested in a company but may not be an owner? Should we also create perhaps an exception for senior executives? So the rule has been published already in the Federal Register. Comments have been made. We are now just waiting to see if the rule becomes final. And once it becomes final, I guarantee you it will be challenged. So you can expect that. See, these are some of the legal challenges of the rule. I'll just let you see the dissent. The FTC is a bipartisan group. There's one Republican. She is the one who dissented, basically saying this is totally different than anything we've ever done in the past. And these are the three things that she raised. First of all, does the FTC have authority to do this? I mean, this is not Congress. This is the FTC. Second of all, does it violate the major questions doctrine? And third, is this an impermissible delegation of Congress's lawmaking power? And so this is kind of a deeper dive, as Stephen Barth likes to say. These are the arguments against from the dissent against the rule. And this is what I think you're going to see when people challenge the rule. Looking at my time here. So, is anybody a sports car fan in here? Okay, well, I am. So, this is a McLaren. Unfortunately, this is not the McLaren that is the subject of the case that we're talking about, but it's more interesting than the hospital. So, I will let you just listen to the lovely sound of that engine. Decision. The McLaren decision involved a hospital called McLaren McCombs. And in that decision, the NLRB basically punished McLaren for their decision to furlough employees that they had to do because of COVID reasons. And when they did that, they provided a severance agreement to these employees. So just so to keep everybody on track, we were just talking about non-competes, now we're talking about severance agreements that have non-disparagement clauses and confidentiality clauses in them. The employees that were furloughed were all asked to sign severance agreements with the confidentiality, this is the actual confidentiality clause, and the non-disparagement clause. Now, the NLRB said, this is not going to fly anymore. So, why did they say that? Well, first of all, the NLRB said the whole purpose behind the NLRA is to promote workers being able to talk about their workplace, being able to challenge their working conditions. And by requiring these employees to basically be quiet, that violates the spirit of the NLRA. And so, for reason number one, we're gonna determine that these agreements are not viable anymore. Number two, public statements by employees about the workplace are central to their rights under the NLRA. So if you're not allowing them to talk, the non-disparagement provisions, they may not be able to perhaps suggest that the NLRA was violated. So that's reason number two that the McLaren decision came to this conclusion. And then number three goes back to the penalties. Offering a severance agreement, not sure what happened. I'll just keep talking. As my mother said she's never had to tell me to speak up in my life. But I'll tell you, reason number three was the penalties, the attorney's fees, the fines, things like that for the violations of the, or breaching the severance agreements was a big deal to the NLRB. One thing that you should be aware of is the NLRB decision not only applies to severance agreements in actuality, but even by you simply offering a severance agreement to your current employee, it also applies to that situation, and that is now a violation if it contains these provisions. So it's not just signing the severance agreement, it's offering the severance agreement to your employee. It is also applicable if the employee asks you for a severance agreement and they want these provisions in there, that's not going to cut it either. So do not be tricked. It is no longer allowed under this decision. Now, the NLRB is not a self-enforcing agency. So when I say it's not allowed, I do not mean that a plaintiff's lawyer is going to come and sue you on behalf of your former employee because you asked them to sign a severance agreement. What I mean is the NLRB actually has to take some sort of action. So there is no private cause of action under this decision, so I don't want you to think that lawyers are going to start lining up filing these suits. So about a month after this decision came out, this was in February, the NLRB issued guidance. And the way that happens is the general counsel gives you sort of some tips on what this means. And again, if you would like more information, you can go to Cozen O'Connor's website. We have interviewed the general counsel for the NLRB, and this is kind of a summary of what she has said. Basically, it is retroactive. It applies to severance agreements even before the decision, which was in February. Supervisors generally are not protected under the NLRA It's generally designed for lower level workers. However, but do not be thinking that you can have a supervisor sign a non-compete and get away with it. What the general counsel has explained is a kind of a hypothetical where if a supervisor is asked to violate some provision of the NLRA or engage in unfair labor practices, then that supervisor will have protection under this rule, this decision, which again is not a final decision yet. Severability, the only probably good thing about the guidance that we learned is that the NLRB is willing to sever out provisions that may be violative of their decision as opposed to voiding the entire agreement. We also learned, as I told you, that even if the employee requested, they want a severance agreement with these provisions in it, it still is unlawful. Like I said, narrowly tailored, this is why there's a sewing machine. I tried to actually put a pair of skinny jeans being tailored on my slide, but I couldn't figure out how to do it. But just remember, narrowly tailoring agreements will help you. It does not mean that you cannot have non-competes. It just has to be tailored. Generally speaking, has to be something like a legitimate business justification. It has to be something like proprietary or trade secret information. When you're broadly asking employees to just not speak, that's going to be a problem. So again, remember the narrowly tailoring language. Non-disparagement. Just because non-disparagement clauses are now considered unlawful in an agreement does not mean that you may not have them in there. It does not mean that your employees can go and disparage you or defame you. So there's not going to be every single type of communication by an employee or a former employee that is protected. And then finally, this is the part that I find to be the most concerning, because as a commercial litigator, every one of my settlement agreements, and they're not severance agreements, but they're settlement agreements, has confidentiality and non-disparagement. And I'm going to show you some examples of agreements that I drafted prior to this rule so you can see them. But there is a question as to whether this is going to apply to other types of restrictive covenants and other types of agreements. And the general counsel full on said that in the podcast that we had our interview with. And she acknowledged that this may end up applying down the road to other types of agreements. So McLaren focused on non-disparagement and confidentiality in the severance agreements, but it also applies to non-disclosures. So NDA is used interchangeably, both as a non-disclosure acronym and a non-disparagement acronym. But some of the things to think about is, you know, is this going to have an adverse effect on the employee? Because you could see some employers saying, then I just won't offer a severance agreement. I'll just bypass that altogether. Some employees may not be at risk for suing you, and so it may not be an issue for those people. The other thing, as we all know, as I know, settlement agreements, severance agreements with non-disclosure provisions, non-disparagement, are very hard to enforce. Simply because your former employee is talking to their spouse or their neighbor does not mean you're going to run down the street and sue them. Now, if you did in state court, let me just bring this up, you might prevail under state court law because the NLRB is not involved in that. So hypothetically, what could happen is, let's say you have a former employee, they have a severance agreement, you've put non-disparagement in there, and you've gotten into a dispute because they've gone on social media and posted something negative about you. You may prevail in state court, but the NLRB also could get involved. That plaintiff's lawyer, some plaintiff's lawyers are not knowledgeable about employment law. If they are, they could try to get the NLRB involved by filing a charge, and then an investigation would ensue. And hypothetically, the NLRB could say, well, you need to reinstate that employee, or you need to not take any action while we decide what to do. So it's sort of akin to those of you who have ever been in front of an administrative law judge or a workers' compensation division. I've been in front of both. There is this whole ancillary agency that could affect what's actually going on in state court. So let me see if I can hit play on this.
There is news this evening involving Tiger Woods. His ex-girlfriend is now suing to cancel a non-disclosure agreement that she says he made her sign years ago. Here's Kena Whitworth.
Tiger Woods first started dating Erica Herman in 2017 when she was the manager at Tiger's Jupiter, Florida restaurant. 6 years later, she's taking the 15-time major champion to court. According to a civil complaint filed Monday, obtained by ABC News, Herman says when they first started dating, Tiger made her sign a non-disclosure agreement, an agreement she is now asking the court to render invalid and unenforceable, or to define the scope of the agreement if any part is enforceable. citing, among other reasons, federal law, specifically the Speak Out Act, which nullifies non-disclosure agreements in cases of sexual assault disputes and harassment disputes. While the filing does suggest the case involves allegations of sexual assault or harassment, it makes no specific allegations against Woods.
Until we know what her rights are underneath this NDA, we won't know who her complaint is against.
So let's just be clear, she doesn't actually know why she is making these allegations. But what I want to make sure everybody understands is there is a significant difference between an NDA in a sexual harassment situation. So Rachel Yucatel, some of you may know who that is, has made a comment about this suit going on with Tiger's most recent ex-girlfriend and has said there is a difference between having somebody sign an NDA at the beginning of your relationship so that you do not disclose what is going on during the relationship versus having somebody sign an NDA to cover up bad behavior. So Tiger's most recent ex-girlfriend, who's bringing this suit alleging the NDA should be voided, is arguing that she should be able to talk about her relationship with Tiger. That's what she's arguing. She's not saying at this point that she has been sexually assaulted or harassed. If that is what she says or argues, she's going to have to prove that, then that might be a different argument. That is what Rachel Yucatel argued. So when you're looking at these agreements, especially in a sexual harassment situation or a workplace sexual assault or violence situation, that is a different cat. And I'll show you an example of a non-disparagement confidentiality clause in a settlement agreement that I drafted in that setting. And you can tell me whether you think it would be enforceable today. One of the things that Tiger's most recent ex-girlfriend is arguing is the Speak Out Act. And the Speak Out Act is basically an act of Congress that prevents what I just discussed, the enforcement of non-disclosures when there's sexual harassment. But again, she's not alleging there was sexual harassment, so that's different. So I don't know how she's going to argue this should be dissolved until she makes that secondary allegation. So this is a confidentiality clause that I drafted in a sexual harassment case that my client was alleged to have an employee. The employee sued the client and said, I was coerced into having a sexual relationship with my boss, who was an executive. So I conducted the investigation, resolved the case, but this was in 2017. And so take a look at that, take your time reading it, tell me if you think that I could have her sign that today. I got lots of swag, just a reminder. So the answer is yes. I could have her sign that today because, again, the NLRB is not going to come into my office and say, Kendall, you have a violation. The way that it would work is in this setting, if I ask her to sign that today, and the other lawyer has to push back, okay? The plaintiff's lawyer sometimes doesn't know a lot about employment law, doesn't know about the NLRB decisions. So, number one, if you don't get any pushback from the other side, then put it in your agreement. It is a different, again, situation if you are trying to enforce it. When you try to enforce it, if the lawyer on the other side is savvy enough, they may alert the NLRB, they may file a charge, they may argue that this somehow applies to them. But I would argue in situations, and by the way, in my case, it was not something where we actually believed that she was harassed. We believed it was consensual. I will not bore you with the photos that I had to look at on various people's cell phones. But in our situation, we were more concerned about her publishing what happened and hurting the company's reputation. So it was not a situation where we truly believed that she was harassed. But even if we did believe that, I'm telling you this would be okay until somebody fights it or tries to enforce it or a federal agency gets involved. And again, that's usually not going to happen in a private setting. So if for some reason you would like to have a confidentiality agreement like the one I drafted in your settlement agreement or your severance agreement, this is the disclaimer language I would recommend that you use. So again, you can cut and paste this from my PowerPoint if you'd like. This language after what you just read will, I don't want to say keep you safe, but it will certainly be a belt and suspenders for you. This is the severance agreement I drafted for the alleged harasser because he was an executive and He was a real problem. I will tell you that he said to me, I cannot make this stuff up. This is why my presentations are fun, because I have these crazy people that I deal with in my cases. And he says to me, I'm in West Texas, all right? I am interviewing him, and I say to him, kind of tell me about your work day. I want to understand how this all happened. Why are there photos of your employee on your phone next to the album with your wife that you're also showing me photos of in her bathing suit? I need to understand, how did we get here? And he says to me, well, you know, it's totally normal in our office for us to kiss each other on the lips. I'm sorry, thank God I live in Dallas and not West Texas. But that came out of his mouth, and I thought, oh my Lord. And I interviewed somebody else that worked with him who was not alleging that she had been harassed or sexually assaulted or coerced into a relationship. She verified what he said. Absolutely, it's totally normal. So this is also something that I think I could enforce today, even after these rules. Again, this is for the harasser or the alleged, you know, the executive. And this is held up to this day. So these are the takeaways for you to remember about both the FTC decision and the McLaren decision. I think McLaren is going to be vacated by a court of appeals. So it has already been appealed. At the time I submitted my PowerPoint and my paper, between then and now, the decision has been appealed. So we'll see what happens. It is not a final decision, it's an agency decision. The NLRB is not a self-enforcing entity. So we'll have to see what happens in an actual appeals court. Right now it's on appeal in the Sixth Circuit. Look at your severance agreements, understand that the rule's not final, so there is no compliance date. There's nothing that's been triggered yet for you to have to be in compliance. It may, by the way, it applies to union and non-union settings. One of the things that the general counsel for the NLRB said in her podcast with us is a lot of people are found in violation, a lot of employers, excuse me, are found to be in violation of this rule because they think if they don't have a union, it doesn't apply to them. So if that is incorrect, it applies in both settings. It may protect a supervisor, as I explained in my hypothetical earlier. Be careful in claims of sexual harassment with the Me Too movement, like the Tiger Woods example. The public interest is paramount. So basically, you can't ask somebody to cover up any wrongdoing in one of these provisions and these restrictive covenants. I would consider whether confidentiality is needed. I mean, I have learned the hard way, if you don't negotiate your confidentiality up front, then it's not gonna be sometimes part of your agreement. But sometimes you don't necessarily want it to be confidential. Sometimes if you have a great settlement, who cares if the plaintiff's lawyer puts it on their website? Sometimes that's actually something helpful for you. Make sure that the legal names of the people involved, the parties involved, are correct, that the legal entities, the suffixes, the LLCs, all of those things are correct. Severability provisions may save the rest of your agreement. As I told you, the NLRB, despite their very broad approach to this, has stated that they will look at provisions on a case-by-case basis. So instead of voiding the whole agreement, they will simply void and sever out the provisions that are in violation of the rule. It should be reasonable and specific, include a temporal limitation. One of the problems in the McLaren case that the NLRB pointed out is that the language said from now and here and after. So it was like, you know, in perpetuity. That is a problem. So make sure there's a limitation. And again, if you're looking at proprietary and confidential information of the company, generally speaking, that will be protected and allowed. It applies, McLaren applies to severance agreements even before the rule came out. Same thing with the non-competes. The FTC decision applies to prior non-competes. Ensure your employees have adequate time to sign an agreement. Some of your management and HR may be contacted if you provide them with one of these agreements, and they may ask to have, they have the right to do this under the NLRA, ask what it means. So make sure that everybody's on the same page about who is addressing those employee comments and what it actually means. I wrote this before the comment period was closed, so you cannot make any comments to the FTC, I'm sorry. There's no private cause of action. This is an agency rule. God bless you. And I will also point out, it's not just a federal agency situation. So my law firm, this is kind of cool, we have something called the State Attorney's General Practice. Has anybody ever heard of that before? Okay. I had not either. When they joined our firm, basically it is a practice group that aligns itself with all of the state attorneys general across the United States. So if your company is investigated, not by the NLRB, but let's say by the Texas Attorney General, if you're in Texas, you can hire us to come and represent your company in opposition to the Attorney General. And because we have a lot of relationships with those people and those Attorneys General, usually it is a amicable discussion and dispute. And there is actually a model rule, it's in my paper, since we're talking about ethics, that addresses this. So I don't want you to think it's only the NLRB and the FTC. There's also entities and other groups at the state level that are looking into this as well. So I have 1 minute and 22 seconds left. Oh no, that means I'm over by 1 minute and 22 seconds. That is all, thank you so much.
Get your phones out, please. Let's do the survey. Kendall, stay right there while they're doing that. If you have any questions, we've got just a few minutes, we could do that. But I do want to make everybody aware that all of these presentations will be available to you. We'll send you an email after the conference, so don't worry about missing something. We'll make sure you have it. Kendall, while they're doing this, I read in the Tiger Woods piece that he had his lawyer break up with her. Would you advise that that's an appropriate breakup method? I'm just curious for my future endeavors.
You know, I read a lot of Us Weekly to take my mind off of scintillating things like this.
Us Weekly.
And I will tell you that I thought the most sort of annoying part about this whole thing, and I don't mean to make this sound like it's a light situation. If there's a harassment problem, obviously that's a different deal. But I think the thing that I noticed the most is she's not exactly sure why she thinks that the non-disclosure should be dissolved. And she was asked to leave his, Tiger asked her to leave his home. So I think she's disgruntled because, you know, that was probably a good situation for her. But no, I would not advise your lawyer ending a romantic relationship.
Yeah, for those of you that don't know, apparently, according to her, he invited her on a trip. They got to the private jet. He didn't go on the jet. His lawyer was on the jet. And when she got on the jet, the lawyer told her they were breaking up and she couldn't go back to the house. So with those facts, counsel, you know, but listen, to be fair, I think she's got 30 million reasons why she's trying to bust the thing. I'm just
having fun. Yeah.
Do we have more swag?
I have, hold on, those of you who did not participate, do not think you can come up here and take the swag out of the podium. I am storing it for this afternoon when I did my very exciting negligent security presentation. But in all seriousness, if there's something that you're dying to have on my table, I would love to meet you. Please come by and grab something.
Let's say thank you very much, Kendall Kelly Hayden. Rolling right along. The Ethics and Compliance Plan, a 2023 must-have document. Joining us today is Juliette Gust, president of Ethics Suite. Julie is out of the Scottsdale, Arizona office, but they have a national and international firm. As you can see from her bio, Juliette brings a wealth of experience in fraud investigations, having worked with Starwood Hotels and Resorts for many years with over 180,000 employees in more than 100 countries. She and her partner at Ethics Suite have developed a very cool reporting mechanism that can help you stay ahead of fraud and harassment claims. And she's here today to talk to us about creating an ethics and compliance plan to keep us out of trouble. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Juliette Gust.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's so great to see some of you again. I have been attending these conferences since 2015, so with Starwood, and as a guest of Deloitte, who are big supporters. I was here in 2015 and 16, and then when we founded Ethics Suite since 2017 as a sponsor. So it's been quite a few years, and I've graduated to reading glasses now for my, so forgive me. But in all that time, I've never been able to coin the phrase, which I would like to do now, the OKOL, office kiss on the lips, because I have to say, after thousands of investigations, that's one that hasn't come up. So you get something new every day. And I can only picture Richard Dawson as that. Those of you who remember him, that's who I see. So the Ethics and Compliance Plan doesn't sound very sexy, but it is. And it's a really great tool for a number of different reasons that we'll go through. A compliance plan, depending on the organization, let me just, can be you know, 2 pages. It could be 7. It could be 40. It really depends on the organizations, the way that it's built, the business models, the risks that are associated with running that business, the industries that it's in, and so on. But a compliance plan and program can be pretty complicated. And so what the plan does is really set forth the overall program just in a summary. And we'll go over why it's important to be able to show that. Let me see this. Am I going backwards? Now I'm stuck. There. Sorry. Okay. So I wrote here the compliance plan is a valuable tool for enhancing the organization's accountability and transparency, but it also demonstrates it, right? It supports it. It provides a kind of guideline, and we're going to go over the overall framework in most detail today for the internal policies and procedures that you should have outlined in the compliance plan. But it shouldn't just be a paper plan. It's really a summary of the key areas of focus for the company. So, for example, depending on the industry that you're in, there may be certain federal laws that you really have to focus on in that compliance plan. Maybe you're in healthcare, maybe you're in education, and so you want to call those out in the compliance plan. You may be in very high-risk locations, so you'd have to tailor it to the specific risks for those locations. And I'm thinking of, you know, those companies that maybe have operations in remote fields or rigs or something like that. We also want to have the compliance plan describe the support for the compliance program, and that would include making sure that senior leadership is involved with the development of the plan and also with the enforcement of all of the items within the plan. So I've seen companies say, you know, we're extremely dedicated to compliance, we have a plan, and then they have a very junior, inexperienced person responsible for managing the day-to-day aspects of that plan, and that just doesn't work. You have to make sure that there's a senior level leader involved, there's support from the board if there is a board, and there's support from senior leadership if there is senior leadership. And again, it depends on the size of the organization, but no matter what the size is, compliance should be a key focus. And why? Because, let me push this forward. All of these great things, right? Legal exposure, penalty, adverse publicity, reputational damage, financial damage. As you saw in my bio, I really talked to just hundreds of people, interviewed them, conducted thousands of investigations, and it really never fails that everyone thinks, how could this happen? How did this happen to me? We almost feel like, besides being investigators, you're kind of a therapist. In helping people understand that, you know, I know that you trusted that person implicitly. That's why this happened, because you didn't have any control over them. You didn't have any oversight over them. You trusted them implicitly. And unfortunately, you just can't do that. As good as people are, as trustworthy as they are, things happen. Life circumstances change. Some people have heartbreaking reasons for why they might do improper things or bad things, but they do them. And so it's important to make sure that there is very realistic oversight over anybody that works in an organization, regardless of their level, regardless of the number of years that they've been there, and regardless of the relationship that they might have with others in that company. The other really growing need for focusing on compliance is the growing focus from the current administration. There have been a lot of memos recently. There's been a lot of attention placed on repeat offenders, on individual accountability, on the renewed focus also on monitorships, which are absolutely no fun. I don't know if anyone here has had to go through one of those, but having someone appointed to your organization to make sure that you're compliant and kind of going through what you're doing on a daily or weekly or monthly or quarterly basis and reporting back to the government is also no fun. So what you want to do is make sure that you try to avoid that at all costs. There's also renewed focus on mergers and acquisitions, because the excuse of, you know, I didn't know that the company that I bought had that issue or problem. I didn't know that they had that environment. I didn't know that they had that tone at the top. That doesn't fly anymore. the due diligence portion of mergers and acquisitions is in focus, and it's important to start the compliance integration early on in the process. And then compensation management has been, to the chagrin of many that I've talked to that have really fought against having this be part of the compensation plan, compliance is now part of that, and it's expected to be part of that. It's expected to have consequences for senior leaders and boards that don't focus on misconduct, that don't address misconduct, that don't root out misconduct, that don't fix the root causes of misconduct. And so they want to know that there's real penalties and there's real financial incentives to do the right thing and punishment for those that don't. Can everybody hear me okay? I'm a little bit soft-spoken, okay. Unless I'm mad. So you can set up the compliance plan really in any way that you think is appropriate for your business, but one, you know, really accepted practice is to focus on the seven elements of an effective compliance program as set forth by the federal sentencing guidelines and then also by the Department of Justice. What the Department of Justice does is require their prosecutors to look at these seven elements and then consider, as far as the overall program, these three questions. Is that program well designed? Is it applied earnestly and in good faith? And then most importantly, does it work? Again, no paper programs, not acceptable anymore. And as far as the design of the program, we'll go into it in detail, but these are really the factors that go into that first question. How often is the risk assessment conducted and what's in it? What are the policies and procedures that cover the organization? What kind of training and communication is provided by the organization? What kind of confidential reporting structure and investigation processes are in place? How are third parties managed? How is due diligence managed? How are they vetted? And as I mentioned before, how are mergers and acquisitions addressed? And then as far as it being applied earnestly, what is the commitment of senior and middle management? What kind of autonomy and resources are given to compliance? And then, as I mentioned before, what are the consequences of not being compliant? And what are the rewards for making sure that everyone in the organization under that umbrella is compliant? And does it work? What happens after investigations? Are root causes addressed? Are problems fixed? Are they prevented from happening again? Is there audit? Is there continuous improvement? Is there monitoring? And not only is there monitoring of the organization, but is there monitoring of the compliance program? Are the compliance resources doing what they're supposed to do? Are they doing what they said they were going to do? There's a lot of organizations that say, you know, we are going to put in a hotline because the EEOC made us, right? So maybe they didn't have one, but there was a settlement, and as a result of that settlement, they have to put in a hotline. And then they forget about it. But how do you know who called the hotline or who entered a digital web form to complain about a certain issue, and what happened once that issue was addressed? Was it ever addressed? There are companies that I see that, you know, usually one of the first questions I ask, what kind of reports have you had? Has this happened before? I don't know is a big one. Or we'll have to ask HR, and then we talk to HR, and HR might say, yes, we've had a lot of instances of this, but they can't prove what they did about it. Maybe they had an Excel spreadsheet listing employee relations issues. Maybe they had some sticky notes on their computer, but they can't really provide any kind of aggregated data that shows these are the issues we had, this is what we did to address them, and this is what we did to prevent them from happening again. So we'll spend a little bit of time on that. And as far as the risk assessments, I wrote here fraud risks, but again, depends on the organization. There are a lot of risks that you can cover. There are some that say have frequent FCPA type risks that come up. There are some, let me just look at my notes real quick, that have trade issues that come up, especially now folks that have operations in Russia or in some of the countries that have been in focus, they may have had to pivot very quickly to change their operations to address that. So the risk assessment is kind of living, breathing, it evolves, it has to be paid attention to, but it's not something that has to be done every year. It depends, again, on the company, on the level, and on the appetite for the risks. You know, it's funny, I saw a meme the other day that I have to share about risk appetite. And it was two gentlemen in a pool with all of the music equipment around it, speakers, and surge protector on top of the water of the pool, and it says that was their risk appetite. And so I have seen companies that are okay with that. And again, depending how you address it, assess it as often as you think you need to, but that's a very serious question that will have to be answered if there's any kind of regulatory scrutiny. If you decide every 3 years is okay for your risk assessment, make sure the reasons why you chose that are documented and that they're sound reasoning and that they were thoroughly reviewed, not just by one particular department, but perhaps by the board of directors as well. Or if there's a risk committee, you can do that too. Policies and procedures, not the most fun, but really key, especially when it comes to preventing misconduct or when it comes to investigating misconduct and then later providing consistent disciplinary action. It's very hard to go to a company to say, for example, favored rock stars or people that have been there longer or people that are related to others within the company. They would exhibit the same behaviors or the same activities as someone else, but completely different outcomes for both of them. One person might be terminated, one person might just get a written warning, or no action at all is taken. These are the things that regulators will look at. Why wasn't there consistent discipline for the same action? And that also sends a message to the rest of the organization that says, well, for some people it's okay. So if it's not okay, it's never okay, and it should be consistent across the board. We also see organizations that have the kind of do as I say, not as I do. And I think some of you have seen that in hospitality, not just recently, but often, as you know, the owner, the CEO can get away with certain behaviors that would never be allowed by other executives or by employees of that organization. So the tone at the top is critical. We talk about it often, but it can't be just lip service. It has to be an example. It has to be lived. And it has to be communicated. Those kinds of policy updates, if they're not properly communicated by senior leadership, then really no one pays attention to them. I'll give you an example. Often if I present or my colleagues present and they discuss, let's say, FCPA. So we're going to have an anti-corruption training. And usually you'll have a senior leader come up at the beginning of the presentation and say, this is important to me, this is important to the organization, the fines are really astronomical if there's an issue and there's regulatory enforcement. So I want you all to pay attention and, you know, live this. And then they walk away and talk on the phone. They pay no attention. So they're really kind of providing the behavior that we really don't want people to exhibit. But they're saying something different. They have to display that. People see that. And training and communication, like I said, be present. Ensure that the code of conduct is not just a one-time thing at onboarding. I talk to hundreds of people who tell me they don't remember the code of conduct. Maybe when I started I saw that, but I don't know. HR handed me a packet. Well, did anybody talk to you about a code of conduct? No, I don't remember seeing it. And this is really key when you're trying to provide discipline, because if you provide a written warning, let's say, about a certain issue that people don't remember knowing that they couldn't even do, it becomes an issue for you. So knowing that they reviewed the code of conduct, that they acknowledged the code of conduct, that they agreed to abide by it, and that they do that annually is very important for a number of different reasons, especially today with the use of cell phones and messaging like WhatsApp. More and more people are using their personal phones to conduct business. And it's very hard to conduct an investigation when you can't take someone's phone. So if there is some sort of bring your own device policy, make sure you have a policy. Does it say that if you're using your personal phone for business, we still have the right to review that information on that telephone? Hard to enforce, of course, but could be a good deterrent. And when we try, you know, I'm just doing an investigation this week, which is some serious issues, and it's almost impossible to find anything in emails because everything is conducted via text message. And I can't just go grab the personal cell phone from somebody to look at the messages. So it's very frustrating, and the Department of Justice has been looking more and more at the use of personal phones, at the use of text messages, at the use of, I guess they're called ephemeral messaging, like Snapchat, WhatsApp, for business. And there'll be more attention paid on what is documented by the company. So consider, if you don't already have policies around that, implementing one. My favorite, confidential reporting and investigation. As I mentioned before, if you have a hotline, how do you talk about it? Do you tell people that it exists? In that compliance plan, this is where you would mention. This is the type of reporting that should be reported through our hotline. This is the type of reporting that if you want. For example, I have clients who have a number of different types of portals. So some of it is geared for those that might want to report anonymously, but some of it is geared for those that have to report certain issues, HIPAA breaches, privacy issues, safety and risks incidents. Those generally are named. You have to name the people involved because of the regulatory issues around them. And so anonymity isn't a problem. But you can provide different channels so that people can feel comfortable either reporting anonymously or not, depending on what they have to say. And then, of course, the consistent response to all of those reports. We see, as I said before, reports that kind of just yelling into the wind. And then when people say, well, I reported this a year ago, and then it comes up again, the Department of Justice will look at that. Regulators will look at that. What did you do when you heard about it the first time? Did you even know that it was reported? Did you take any steps to address it? And this really goes with the trained triage and investigations resources. You don't have to have a specific team that does this, but whoever is responsible for doing it should be trained, should know to look for red flags, should know to see kind of the hidden messages, read between the lines that could happen when people are reporting an issue. So, for example, in the hospitality industry, you can see a report comes in, hey, I have a conference that is sponsored by the government, it's a government agency, and we're not allowed to have food. So can you write an invoice where my food is coded as audiovisual? Well, someone might want to ask, can I do that? They can use the ethics line to do that. They can check in. But someone not trained reading that report, if it did happen, can say, well, this is an invoicing issue. But it's not. Maybe it's a False Claims Act issue. And so I've seen companies where, you know, the executive assistant to internal audit is the one reading the reports, and they miss these red flags. And so they should be trained, and they should be very quickly able to escalate issues to the right people. The other thing that we see are those who are responsible for intake of whistleblower issues are named in the whistleblower issues. So what are the circumstances around that? What are the plans that are already in place in the compliance plan that spell out for everyone to see, this is what happens if a report comes in about the CEO. This is what happens if a report comes in about a member of the board. Third-party due diligence is another factor that should be spelled out in the plan. How are they addressed? How are they vetted? There's so many problems that go on with third parties. I'm sure you're all aware. The FCPA fines are, so many of them are because of the acts of a third party. And just recently, I did an investigation in the real estate sector with some involving hotels where the real estate executive within the organization colluded with an outside party to create shell companies. And the same two people were able to inflate the price of real estate and dupe the organization when they were buying it. And also on the other side, when they were selling it, they sold it at a price that was way too low, below market, because they trusted the real estate executive. But this real estate executive that colluded with the third party, they just used some really great sounding LLCs to be able to execute that. And so all the senior leaders in the organization saw were, wow, I'll just say, you know, Houston Hotel Authority. That sounds great. But it was the same guy. So they did it at least 8 times that I can tell you about, and defrauded the company of millions of dollars. And what they did was they would kind of work in these consulting fees that they, with the inflation of the price, that they hid from the organization because that person that worked for the organization was responsible for the negotiation. And then they would split it afterwards, and so nobody knew about it for quite some time. But that's why I say joint venture partners, representatives, consultants, business partners, third-party management isn't just, you know, your vendors, but anyone else that you might do business with, anyone associated with the organization. We talked a lot about mergers and acquisitions, so I won't spend too much time on it, but I don't know if you all remember a while back, Morgan Stanley was in the news because they had an FCPA issue, and they did not get a civil money penalty because they had such a strong program in place. And so the DOJ considered the person responsible for the acts of bribery a rogue actor, and it was a really great case for everyone to see that the strength of a compliance program can save you a lot of money and penalties in attorney fees, in monitorships, and in other areas. And so one of the things, I worked with Morgan Stanley for quite some time right around that period, and one of the things I saw was a real amazing dedication in the mergers and acquisition space. You know, they put teams together way before the completion of a merger that would map out the compliance program for Morgan Stanley and the compliance program for the target acquisition. And then they would look for gaps. And they would address, again, far before the time period that it had to be implemented, what do we have to do? Do they have the same enforcement that we do? Do they have the same mindset that we do? Do they have the same commitment to compliance that we do? And if they didn't, they addressed that beforehand. And so they made sure that people were trained, they made sure that programs and policies and procedures were changed, so that by the time the merger happened, it was already in place and ready to go. And I have to say, compliments. I don't know if anyone's here from Marriott, but same thing. I work for Starwood, Marriott acquired it. We had months of review with the compliance team in describing, you know, what were the different policies, programs, issues. You know, they were well in advance of that. Autonomy and resources and commitment to senior management kind of go hand in hand, because as I mentioned before, does senior management allow that autonomy? I've seen internal audit directors that are told what they're going to audit by senior leaders. They really don't have that independence. They don't have that direct line to the board. They certainly don't have the comfort level of being able to approach the board if there are issues as well. So the compliance plan should spell out the kind of reporting lines for internal audit, the resources for internal audit and compliance, and the level of commitment that'll be there for them. We talked about compensation and consequence management, but the incentives has been very interesting. So for example, the real estate executive that I mentioned before was not only a real estate executive, but also a broker for the company. So they had a further incentive to drive up the price because they also earned a commission on it. So that conflict of interest, those things have to be addressed. Are the people involved in some of the sales practices? If they're earning commissions, is there a very strict guidelines? Are they outlined in the compliance plan to show what are the commissions that are okay? Are conflict of interest disclosed? Are they vetted? Are they approved? And in some cases I've seen in hospitality where commissions can be used to launder money, they can be used to provide terrorist funding, and so making sure that the agreements that are in place, particularly with the groups from other countries or what I like to call high net worth individuals that have their own teams that may be sending someone in advance, scouting in advance to look at rooms for a delegation, for example. You know, how are those people paid? Do they get commissions? What happens with those commissions? Are they paid in cash? Are they requested to be paid in cash? So very strict guidelines on how funds are distributed in terms of commissions and incentives is important. I think we spent a lot of time already on investigation of misconduct, but the root cause analysis is one that many people don't do. They want to, and understandably so, there's an issue in the organization, people want to have it addressed, they want to have it off their plate, they want to have consequences meted out and then forget about it. But the fact is that really the reason for that misconduct has to be addressed. And again, regulators will expect that. What did you do to determine why what happened happened? Do you need to have more policies in place? Do you need to have more oversight? Do you need to have better vetting of third parties? Do you need to have better background checks of employees before they come in? These are the things that will be reviewed so that one can see how to prevent that similar behavior from occurring. Now, for large organizations, in some cases, things will happen, especially simple things. Theft of cash, that's one that's a constant updating of internal controls to address it. But FCPA-type issues, those can really be addressed firmly and quickly, making sure that you have the right training in place, the right programs in place, the right internal audit, doing proactive audits of issues like that. Internal audit doesn't only have to do SOX, they don't only have to do financial management, but they should be reviewing data. So for example, they can go into financial management systems and look for keywords so that they can determine if there were improper payments made. They can go in and look for hotline reports and see what was addressed. How did it happen? How fast did it happen? And I've got 4 minutes for questions. I know Steven has some. Wait,
I have. Let me get with the microphone, please. Thank you. Yep. Thank you. Oh, real quick question while I'm coming. Is anybody cold or is it just me? It's freezing. Okay. I'm going to work on that. I'm going to hand you the microphone. I'm going to work on the temperature.
Hopefully my teeth won't chatter. I'm just curious if there's any litigation around these. I'm dating myself, but we used to call them Kelly services that would provide temporary employment. There's a lot of these that are popping up on social media. Is there any litigation around those companies? Because if you as a corporation hire someone that is, I can't even think of the name of one, that applies for a job, like a housekeeper job or something, and then you find out that that was a company that also does not have any kind of, or has not done their homework on human trafficking or sex trafficking, is there any litigation around those type companies?
So I'll defer to the lawyers here on the litigation, but I can tell you about the investigations I've conducted, which are frequently what you mentioned. Yes, and again, that goes back to the vetting of a third party, and not just the initial vetting, but the constant vetting. So right here in Houston specifically, temporary staffing, $3.5 million embezzlement, where there were 33 ghost employees. The temporary staffing agency had an agreement. This is what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to vet, you're supposed to hire people. Right? You're supposed to make sure that they're cleared to work and that they have the appropriate documentation. You're supposed to schedule them, and you're supposed to make sure that they go to work and that they do what they're supposed to do. And if there's any kind of vacation time or training issues, you handle them. Well, that didn't happen at all. They did none of that. They allowed the hotel to give them new employees. They were using false Social Security numbers. They didn't run them through anything. They didn't vet that the documentation was appropriate. They didn't schedule them. And so they didn't know that there were 33 ghost employees on that schedule for more than 3 years. So yes, it happens. I can think of another company in Florida, same thing, temporary staffing agency, agreement in place, vetted by all the appropriate, you know, attorneys for the company, have the, you know, this is great. Because a lot of these companies are very good at, they know the documents that they need. They know what they're supposed to say, and then once all that is in place, that is just isn't what happens in practice. And nobody audits. Nobody checks back to make sure, at least once a year, hey, you know what, let's grab 10 applications, let's grab 10 employee files, and make sure that they exist, that all the documents they needed are there, that they show up to work. And sometimes I used to take the roster of names to the hotels and show the managers, and restaurants too, I've seen this, and show the managers, do you know who they are? Never seen them before. But it also showed a weakness in management where they didn't know because they weren't there. There was no, you know, management by walking around. They had no idea who the staff was. They were kind of off doing other things and not interested in that daily one-on-one interaction. Sorry, Stephen. Did that answer your question?
I think you did. That's terrific. You know, sometimes we just don't know who's working for us. I mean, we hired a guy one time. We didn't know he was drunk until we saw him sober one day. So we we're like, dude, where did you come from? the temperature will be brought down. It'll take about 15, 20 minutes. I'm sorry, up. Excuse me. Thank you very much. Yeah, up. Thanks for that. We have time for one more question. We got it, Okay. Juliette, you get great. Always give a great pathway. That is a terrific outline for you to take back to your ranches and to develop your own policies and procedures. Juliette, thank you, as always.
Thank you.
Please say thank you. Moving right along now, we're going to talk about website litigation under the Americans with Disabilities Act. Protect your property from lawsuits. Joining us today is Jordan Schwartz. Jordan is a partner in the Kahn Massiel Carey Law Firm. He's based in Washington, D.C., but he has a national practice representing hotels across the country in ADA litigation, but he also has a broader scope practice around all aspects of labor and employment law, and he focuses in that area on unionized and non-unionized workplaces, and especially dealing with things with the NLRB. We have Jordan all over the country to assist us in educating folks about the ADA. We're fortunate to have him with us today. Please welcome Jordan Schwartz.
Thanks a lot, Steve. It's good to be back here in Houston. It's been a while for me. I think last year I did it telephonically. So I see some familiar faces and some new faces. So I'm going to talk just generally about the ADA for a few minutes, and then I'll get into primarily websites, although what I do is both try to protect your property from ADA lawsuits via websites or ADA lawsuits at your actual, you know, brick and mortar place of business. So I'll throw both of them in there. Most of you here probably will know this, but just to be, you know, certain, you know, the ADA is broad. There's various different aspects of the ADA, that, you know, called titles. Some of you might just see the words ADA and think, oh, I'm talking about, you know, the more common, which is Title I, which deals with your workplace ADA issues when an employee asks for a reasonable accommodation. If you have any questions about that later, I can talk to you about that, but that is not the subject of this presentation. This presentation is about Title III of the ADA, which applies to your either physical place of business or your website and your guest and customer access. Most people in this room, I assume, are in either a hotel, a restaurant, some type of place of public accommodation. If that applies to you, the ADA and Title III of the ADA certainly does apply to you. The second bullet point here, I just put hotels to save space, but it applies to all places of public accommodation. And it prohibits you from denying services and accommodations to individuals with disabilities. Of course, I don't think anyone is going to just say to someone with a disability, no, we're not going to provide you with an accommodation. So what it means, it's more implicit bias, where the ADA is prohibiting you from having what's called barriers to access. Things that obviously in a physical structure would be a stairs and no ramp, would be no accessible parking spaces, would be no accessible restrooms. Similarly, there are aspects on websites that I'll get to. So what the ADA does, it requires you to remove those barriers to access so someone with a disability cannot claim that they're being discriminated against because they cannot use your facility. So, you know, that in any store, in any restaurant, in any hotel, you can just think of dozens and dozens and dozens of modifications that you need to make to your property to make sure it is ADA compliant without even knowing the law. Of course, if you know the law and the specs, there are certain measurements and things, but just kind of common sense, you can see where someone, let's say in a wheelchair, could or could not get to areas of your place of business. The big thing I want to point out that, you know, I say this in every presentation, and I gave a presentation about 10 days ago in Las Vegas, and right after, you know, someone disagreed with me for a minute, so I had to explain it to her again, that there is no grandfather clause. And, you know, what she had told me was her architect or her city, you know, council representative told her that there was a grandfather clause. And I just don't know why there's so much misinformation out there. But if your property, the ADA went into effect in 1991, I believe. If your property was built before then, your place of business, that doesn't matter. You can't just say, oh, we're fine, we were built before then, we don't have to comply with the ADA. You still need to comply. There are certain modifications to the ADA that went into effect in, they're called the 2010 standards, they went into effect in 2012. You might have a little bit difference in what standards you need to apply, but the ADA still does apply to you, and it is just not an excuse or a defense to say, oh, we're an old property. So please keep that in mind. And if you're under that impression, you need to kind of get rid of that mindset and take steps to become more compliant. I want to talk to you a little bit about this brand new case. It came out, the decision came out about a month ago, where It's a little bit of kind of turning things on their head in regards to standing. And this is a big thing in the ADA, where I've written a lot of motions to dismiss, getting rid of cases on behalf of my clients because the plaintiff didn't actually have standing. And what happened here was a disabled individual sued a hotel company in Maine. She said that the hotel's website didn't contain enough information regarding disability accommodations. And in a few minutes, I'll tell you what information you need to, if you're a hotel, that you need to provide. She could have called the hotel to ask about the accessible features at the property, but she actually didn't really want or need the information. She was functioning as what's called an ADA tester. The whole purpose of her going to the website was to see if she could file suit. And the district court, as most courts do, dismissed the case for lack of standing, which means there was not a concrete or particularized injury. Usually, you need to say, oh, I want to go to your property, but I couldn't do so because of the lack of accessibility. She didn't do that, so the district court said she wasn't injured. She was not injured. The First Circuit surprisingly reversed the district court, and it said the denial of accessibility information in and of itself is an accessible, it is an actionable injury. And that's really, really important because A, it's in direct conflict with other circuits. So now the Supreme Court has now granted cert, and we're actually gonna planning on writing an amicus brief on behalf of places of public accommodation, explaining why the outcome of this case will be so crucial. Because right now, this case is in the hotel context, and it's in the website context. But it really doesn't matter if you're a hotel, if you're a restaurant, if you are thinking about it in the website context or the non-website context. Again, up until this case, a plaintiff had to say, I am planning, let's say I'm visiting Houston and coming to this hotel, what information can you provide? Then the hotel had to provide the information. Now, someone in Maine can sue a property in California just saying, oh, I was perusing the website and I'm harmed by this information that's not accessible. Same thing with planning on going to a store. They could potentially look at a picture and say, oh, I wasn't even planning on visiting your store 3,000 miles away, but I see there's a step going into your property. I'm going to sue based on lack of accessibility. Based on the same reasons that the First Circuit mentioned, that lawsuit could potentially be successful. So the outcome of this case really is going to be a pretty big, what's the word? which way it's going to go? It's going to be a big point to decide whether it'll be more easier or much more difficult for plaintiffs to file these types of what are called serial tester lawsuits, people who just want to test the ACA and don't actually have a legitimate interest in visiting your property. So with that being said, we're going to talk now specifically about website accessibility. Last year, the DOJ finally weighed in. We've been waiting since 2010 for them to weigh in. They didn't really say that much. They said, we want your websites to be accessible. We said, how so? They said, we don't really know. There's guidance out there called the Web Content Accessibility Guidance. Try to follow that the best you can. They gave some examples of things you need to do. I have in this last bullet point, although I'm going to talk about that in a little more detail in about three or four slides. But it is important to know that the DOJ specifically said websites should be accessible, but it's just guidance. So at the end of the day, it's not actual law. But the DOJ does enforce the ADA in some occasions. Sometimes it's a private lawsuit. Sometimes it's the DOJ bringing an action. So it is important to know, but it's not as crucial as, let's say, the Supreme Court case that I just described. So when I'm talking about ADA website accessibility, keep in mind, and people get confused about this, I wish there were two different names. There's two completely different buckets for the big rubric of ADA accessibility. Bucket number one, does your website need to actually be accessible? That means, can users with visual and hearing impairments actually use your website? So that's the first bucket that I'll talk about for the next few minutes. And then I'll go into the second bucket, which is actually what Ms. Laufer sued about in the case I just described. Does your website need to provide information regarding various accessible features at your hotel? So if someone says, oh, I have a website accessibility lawsuit, until you ask more information, you don't know if they're talking about number one or number two. And again, they're very different lawsuits, and you need different experts and completely different analyses. So you need to find out more information to know who to know how to remedy either of these cases, either of these situations. But let's go to the first one first. Must my website be accessible for those who have difficulty hearing and seeing? And this is what the DOJ guidance was talking about. The DOJ guidance said yes. Courts, for the most part, have said yes. There's an 11th Circuit case recently that actually said no. But almost all courts have at least moved in this direction. So I strongly urge you not to just rely on, oh, I heard about one case that said my website doesn't need to be accessible, so I'm not going to take the, I'm not going to make the effort to make the website accessible. It really is worth your time to at least look into the accessibility of your website and then determine what to do from there. Let me explain for a minute, just in case some of you don't know, I don't want to get ahead of myself. What this means when I'm talking about making your website is accessible is that someone who is visually impaired most likely has their own what's called screen reader software that they use on their own computer. And that makes the website, it might read a website to them. It might make the font a lot larger. It might contrast the colors better. So the person who's looking at the website has the screen reader software on their own end. What you as a business need is to have your website that is compatible with screen reader software. Just putting a generic website without taking steps to make it compatible, it likely will not be compatible. So your obligation as a place of public accommodation is to take steps so that the screen reader software can interact properly with your website. And this is just a case from a few years ago in which a California lower court dismissed a lawsuit brought by a plaintiff against Domino's. The plaintiff tried to order pizza. He wasn't able to do so. And the lower court basically said, well, the ADA doesn't say anything about website accessibility. You know, I'm dismissing the lawsuit. But then the Ninth Circuit, which is the, you know, Court of Appeals for California, Nevada, basically everywhere on the West Coast, said, wait, hold on a minute. The Title III of the ADA, even though when it was written, didn't specifically mention websites, it certainly does apply to a place of public accommodation. And thus, the plaintiff really did have both standing and a legitimate claim against Domino's. Domino's appealed to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court denied cert, so at that point, we were hoping the Supreme Court would finally weigh in on the issue. They have not. So at least in the Ninth Circuit, and again, most areas of the country, this is, for lack of a better word, established law. The one outlier here is the 11th Circuit, which is Florida, Alabama, and Georgia, I believe, where Winn-Dixie, an individual tried to use the grocery store, Winn-Dixie, coupons on the website, wasn't able to use the website. And the lower court found that there was an ADA violation, because Winn-Dixie is a store, Winn-Dixie has a website, and the website and the store had a sufficient nexus between each other. And thus, if the store needed to be ADA compliant, the website also needed to be ADA compliant. The 11th Circuit, however, reversed and said, wait, the ADA doesn't specifically say that. We're not going to read text into the ADA. So only actual physical places need to be ADA compliant. Again, this is an outlier case, but it is the leading case in the 11th Circuit. And at some point, the Supreme Court needs to weigh in on this. The Supreme Court won't weigh in on it in that standing case that I mentioned, but hopefully sometime soon it will weigh in. And if you have a property in Florida, Alabama, or Georgia and follow this, you could be the test case for another plaintiff bringing this case before the Supreme Court. So the common issues I'm talking about when we're thinking about whether websites are compliant, big one is menus in PDF format. Some of you might have that on your website. Others, I'm sure everyone in this room has gone to restaurant websites, hotel websites that have menus. You click on the menu, it comes up in a PDF. More likely than not, that PDF is not ADA compliant. It's possible it is. It's possible that it has been reformatted, but the default is 9 times out of 10, it's not ADA compliant. So if you have that on your website, that's something, you know, you really do wanna look into. If you have pictures, symbols, maps, diagrams with no written descriptions, you need something, you know, the jargon is alt text. You need alternatives. You need text as an alternative to pictures. You need both. Different links that just say click here, text has an image file, video and audio files with no captioning, all of those are problems. A big one people don't realize that get a lot of companies in trouble is navigating a website without a mouse. So let's say you're looking to book a room at a hotel. You're using your keyboard, you're using your mouse, you're doing whichever. But then you have to use your mouse to move the cursor to the bottom of the page where it says click now to reserve. If you have to do that and you can only use a mouse, that is an ADA issue right there. Because someone who is visually impaired will not be able to see where the cursor is blinking and click on the click here button. So you need to be able to use a keyboard. You cannot have a website that just requires you to use a mouse for certain transactions. So what you want to do, what I, in all my presentations, urge people to do is retain an accessibility consultant to look at your website and determine whether or not it's ADA compliant. You know, I use a company that I work with quite often, they do this initial review of your website for free. Granted, most likely they're going to find issues and then they're going to offer to help fix, and then that won't be free. But at least you can get a sense at the outset whether or not your website has issues. What you also want to do is retain legal counsel when you retain the ADA accessibility consultant. And I know you think, oh, that's, you know, extra money, why do we need that? But it really is important. If you retain the ADA consultant and then he or she finds all the different ways in which your website is deficient, and then a few weeks later you happen to get sued, and then the plaintiff in discovery asks for all the documents about your ADA, about your website, including these smoking guns that show how your website is not ADA compliant, you have to turn them over. But if you also have an attorney who hires the accessibility consultant under the attorney privilege doctrine or work product doctrine, that document will then be privileged and you will not have to turn it over to the plaintiff. One thing a lot of people do after they listen to my presentations is they Google and they say, you know what I can do? I can save money. I don't need to spend money hiring a lawyer or an accessibility consultant. There's some online, they're called online accessibility widgets. I can just use them. They can look for accessibility related issues on my website. Unfortunately, those are not sufficient. From the experts I talk to, they only catch about 20 or 30% of the actual issues. If they tell you you're not compliant, you're definitely not compliant, but if they tell you you are, like a false positive, you actually need human auditors to review the website. And quite frankly, some companies put on their websites the accessibility widget and say, this has been reviewed by these accessibility widgets. A savvy plaintiff sometimes specifically sues companies that have put those accessibility widgets on their websites because they know they will not be ADA compliant. So just be very cautious if you just try to save money by using accessibility widgets. Another thing you want to make sure to do, and this is very easy, is put some sort of accessibility statement on your website. The DOJ, in that guidance I referenced earlier, mentioned that this is helpful. Courts have actually ruled for companies simply because they've had an accessibility statement, and also plaintiffs are less likely to sue you if they see a statement that basically says, we have reviewed our website for ADA compliance. We have made our best efforts to be compliant. Here is our number. If you have any questions, please give us a call. It is not 100% foolproof, but it is much, much better to have this than not have this. You can work, you know, with your legal counsel, someone like me, to come up with a statement in an hour or two, and then you have a lot more protection. So that's something I strongly urge you guys to do if you do not have one already. Quick question to end this topic, and I assume most of you here will know the answer. Unfortunately, I do not have any swag. I didn't really think of that. Next time I'll do that. I have some clients, and they've called me, and they said, oh, I just got sued for website violation. Good news, it's the same lawsuit as a few months ago. We're good, right? And I hope all of you know that my answer was, unfortunately, no, you're not good. Just because you have a settlement agreement with a prior plaintiff, a new plaintiff does not care at all what you agreed to with the prior plaintiff. So the best thing you can do is, if you do settle a case with a prior plaintiff and you have time to fix the... Let me back up for a second. When I settle a case on behalf of my client with a plaintiff, I get my client as much time as I can, maybe a year, maybe 2 years, to fix the website. I don't want, if something happens, if there's, I don't know, an international pandemic and things can't, you know, get done, I don't want my client to be sued for breach of contract. However, I also tell my client, I want you to fix the website as soon as possible, because if you don't, you're liable for other lawsuits. So the best way to reduce your legal exposure is to make changes as soon as you can. If you get sued, you agree to fix them ASAP, even if your settlement agreement gives you plenty of time. Moving on to the second bucket here. Now let's kind of, for the next 5 minutes, forget about everything we were just talking about with screen reader software and things of that nature. We are now on the second bucket, which is the information that hotels need to list on their website. If you are not a hotel, the next 5 minutes do not apply to you. But if you are a hotel, there is specific regulations on the ADA that you must do certain things. Number one, you must make on your website, allow an individual to make a reservation for an accessible room in the same way someone can make a reservation for a non-accessible room. You cannot say, we have accessible rooms. If you need one, please give us a call. That would be, remember I mentioned in the beginning, discriminatory treatment. That would be discrimination, allowing some members of the public to reserve a room online and other members not to do so. You need to make sure that guest rooms are held for use by individuals with disabilities until all other guest rooms of that type have been rented. If you have one accessible king room, do not rent that accessible king room to the first person who calls and asks for a king room. Hold that. So in case someone needs it, you can then give it to that person. Reserve upon request accessible rooms. The specific type that someone reserves and block all the others from the system. Where this happens a lot is someone reserves an accessible room with a roll-in shower. You don't specifically block that one. You get to the hotel and they say, oh, sorry, that room's been taken, but don't worry, we have another accessible room. Oh, sure, it has a tub, but that should be fine for you, right? And, you know, when someone gets to a property and they don't have the room that they requested, that's where big issues come. So make sure that the specific room is held and that it's blocked from the reservation system. And then the last one here, which is the one that Ms. Laufer sued in that case that's going to the Supreme Court, that almost all of the second bucket of accessibility lawsuits are, as a hotel, you need to identify and describe the accessible features of your hotel on your website. This is much easier than hiring an accessibility consultant and doing all those testing. This is talking to your attorney and having them walk through your property or discuss the accessible features of your property, putting a tab on your website, and just coming up with a bullet point list of what are accessible features at your property. So someone, a serial tester or someone who's actually coming to your property can look and see, oh, they have accessible parking. They have accessible restrooms. They have accessible tables at their restaurant. They have a pool lift. I know I can go visit them. There's no actual law on exactly what information you need to provide, but it's kind of common sense. For the common areas, as I just said, you want to talk about the entrance, you want to talk about the restaurant, you want to talk about parking, you want to say if there are accessible routes. Don't just find a different hotel website and then cut and paste what they have. That would be really a big problem if someone comes to your property and then you don't have what you said you have. You also want to provide sufficient information regarding your rooms. And what that means is, as I mentioned earlier, some accessible rooms have roll-in showers, some have tubs, some have one bed, some have two beds. So you want to provide all that information. Also, if you're a hotel, you want to make sure to have what's called dispersion of different rooms. You actually cannot tell someone who's disabled, oh, sorry, we only have king rooms for you, or we only have rooms with roll-in showers, or we don't have any suites. You know, anything that's you have for individuals who don't have disabilities, you want some sort of commensurate inventory. For individuals with disabilities. It doesn't have to match 100%, but you want to make the inventory somewhat similar, and you want to provide that information on your website. And the last slide here is, and hotel owners and operators hate this slide, but you need to be careful with the Expedias of the world. The last 5 minutes, what I've been talking about, that those regulations only apply to hotel owners and operators, but Expedia provides information about your hotel. So unfortunately, plaintiffs will look at and start to single out Expedia. It could be Orbitz, it could be hotels.com, it could be any of those. They can look at what information is provided and then sue you as a hotel for Expedia or Orbitz not providing the correct information. I know it seems extremely unfair, but that is the law. So you need to work with your online travel agent and make sure that whatever information you have about your hotel, you provide it to them so they can provide the correct information to the public. And then we can also talk about structuring your contracts for indemnification provisions and things of that nature. And with that said, I am 30 seconds over time.
Winner. Okay. Questions? We have a question right here. 1 second, Jordan.
Hey there. So I was curious, how much of this applies to apps?
I mean, it's interesting. I need to update my presentation a little bit, because what I should have said at the beginning is there's very little of this that doesn't apply to apps. It's the same rationale. You know, I don't know the ins and outs about as much about the actual accessibility in terms of how the website consultants can build the apps and things of that nature, but it's the exact same analysis that the apps need to be compatible with whatever the software is that's reading the app, because it would be, you know, discriminatory, unfair, whatever the word you want to look at to say, oh, you're disabled, you now can't use this hotel's app. You have to go to their website, but someone who's not disabled can go to the app.
Great question. Great answer. I promise it's supposed to get warmer in here. They have sworn to me it's going to get warmer.
What about lighter, Steve?
I'm working on that, yeah.
I think it's getting darker by the minute.
Just one thing about the surveys. Once you get access, if you leave it open on your phone, you don't have to go back to the QR code each time. I see everybody going, something I probably should have said before. Sorry. Here you go, Juliette.
Thank you. Hi, Jordan.
Hi, good to see you.
I find that I've been asked more and more by prospective clients for something called a VPAT, this voluntary product assessment template that covers every possible accessibility issue. Do you find that your clients are being asked for that by, I don't know, corporate clients or conferences or?
Not much, no. I actually don't know much about that. And if it's
like a voluntary audit on your own.
Yeah, no, I'll have to look into that. That's a great question, but I still think you need some sort of human auditing in addition to that, just for all the reasons I mentioned. But I can't comment on the actual, how, you know, the success rate on that without knowing more.
Okay,
but that's a great question.
Yeah, thank you.
What was the acronym again?
VPAT.
AT, Voluntary Product Assessment Template. And it is filled out by a human, so it's like an audit, and someone, a third party, has to.
Yeah, it's VPAT, but I just don't know the intricacies enough.
Okay, very cool. Let's say thank you to Jordan. Now we're going to talk about force majeure clauses in the post-COVID reality. How many of you during COVID got really tired of reading force majeure clauses? Raise your hands. Yeah, right. So joining us today is David Denney, the founder of the Denney Law Group, Dallas, Texas. David is very active with the local restaurant associations. He's their go-to guy, and actually he's been an officer and a board member for many years, as you can see. David's primary focus is representing independent restaurant bars, caterers, excuse me. He was one of the first people to really identify the ghost kitchen concept, and so we're very fortunate to have him with us today to talk about this very important topic of force majeure clauses. Please welcome David Denney.
Thanks, everybody. Looking at that intro slide, I used to make fun of you guys who did not update your bio photo for a while. And this morning when I was looking into the very zoomy hotel mirror, I realized that it was 6 years ago, and the last 6 years have wrought a little bit of havoc on my face and hair color, and I will never do that to you guys again. I mea culpa on that. I apologize retroactively for all of those comments I put in my head. So we're in officially a post-COVID reality now, thank God. I will tell you that because I have a very niche practice in the independent restaurant space, talk about putting all your eggs in one basket. On March 16th of 2020, I canceled all my firm's magazine subscriptions because I thought we were probably going out of business. We did not, but it was a little dicey there for a while. And I'm sure a lot of you felt the same way, whether it was hotel, travel, risk management, law, hospitality, restaurants. We all took it, and we all watched our clients take it, and it sucked. And so here we are in 2023, hoping that we never have to go through this again. Unfortunately, we have this guy to listen to.
The worst of this one is through, and the next one, when it comes, could be a lot worse.
Sorry. Bill has at least predicted we will have another pandemic. So we should probably talk about how to address it in the legal documents that we have in front of us before it becomes a reality for the new reality, and we have to look backwards and say, why didn't we deal with this in our contracts? So is this being recorded? I can't remember if we record these. Okay, so I just finished the trial over force majeure during COVID, and I will talk about it offline with anybody who wants to talk about it, but I will not talk about the details of it because this is being recorded, and I have very strong emotions about why we lost that trial. And so if anybody wants to hear that very raw wound, I'm happy to discuss how that trial went out in Denton County in April of 2023. So. When people talk about force majeure clauses in contracts, we really, even as lawyers who know better, we often glaze over them as boilerplate. They tend to be right above the severability clause, and severability is a good thing, and we want it in there, and force majeure is a good thing, and it never comes up. So most people just sort of glaze over it. Except that in the thousands of leases that I have negotiated or presided over the negotiation of in my career, force majeure is a pretty important one. And in commercial leases, and we'll talk in a little while about force majeure in other contracts because they're in a lot of contracts and they need to be in more, frankly, I think. But in leases, the old way of doing force majeure was, okay, so let's get off of Bill and talk about what force majeure is. And then we'll talk about where it goes and why. So force majeure is Frenchy, and it refers to things that are beyond a party's control in a contract. And most of us have dealt with this in some form or another, whether it's lease or a VRBO rental for ourselves privately or for our clients or for a UCC purchase of goods or whatever. Force majeure clauses are in there. So it deals with unexpected events that goes beyond the contemplation of the contracting parties and it affects a party's or both parties' performance. So. It comes from French civil law. It does not come from English common law, and therefore we don't have this history of, you know, hundreds of years of jurisprudence dealing with force majeure clauses. And what that really means is when the rubber meets the road is we have to specifically tailor them every time we see them. And I know that's a big CLE thing to say, like, oh, you should specifically tailor every paragraph of every contract you've ever worked on. It's harder to do in practice, but we really should. And form-based practice is the way to oblivion. And so we shouldn't do that, and we should be drafting these provisions with an end to, looking to an end that will benefit the parties in that particular contract. Even if you've seen it 1,000 times, it needs to be looked at with some regularity because you just never know what could happen. And so what the historic sort of commercial lease force majeure clause would say is in your standard landlord, commercial landlord form, I'll go ahead and tell you, I have in-group bias toward tenants. I represent tenants, we don't represent landlords. The landlords in this scenario are the black hats, the tenants are the white hats. I think that's probably already clear, but that's where I'm coming from in this, and so that is my particular bent. But in commercial leases, generally speaking, unless you're somebody like a Starbucks and you show up with your own lease form, most tenants don't have that. Most tenants do not have the bargaining power to show up with their own lease form, their own provisions, and so we're dealing with whatever the landlord uses for their properties, whether it is a mom and pop owns one piece of commercial property with one building in it, or somebody who owns properties all over the country managed by a management committee, and they're a big fat REIT that owns thousands of properties, anything in between, they're probably going to give you their lease form first. And so the force majeure clauses that we normally see only apply to landlords, and if they do apply to the tenants, they don't apply to the tenant's obligation to pay money under the document. And so if you have a catastrophic force majeure like COVID, and you have a clause in that force majeure that says this does not apply to the payment of money, it doesn't matter whether you have force majeure because you still got to pay rent. And so what it might help you if you're building out your space, you're building your restaurant, and it says a shortage of materials can be a force majeure, and you don't have the lumber needed to build your restaurant, then it might apply. It might move your commencement date, they might move your construction obligations, but it won't. Once you hit rent's commencement, it's not going to stop the payment of money and all the pass-through expenses you have to pay, and that sucks. And so we want to tailor these to the reality of the tenant's economics, because the landlord's economics are always going to be pretty good. It's good to be the landlord, it's good to be the king, it's good to be the owner of the commercial property. So we're sort of fighting an uphill battle against the people with most of the bargaining power most of the time, especially in my practice, which is independence. We don't have 1,000 units to deal with. We have tens and 20s and 30s most of the time, and sometimes ones and twos. So what you might see in a force majeure clause is application to the landlords, inapplicability of that clause to the payment of rent, lots of undefined terms, like act of God, governmental restriction, more about governmental restriction later, and limitations on the time period. The tenant claiming force majeure can actually be in force majeure regardless of whether force majeure lasts longer than the contract says it does or not. So there could be a sneaky provision, which is what commercial landlords like to do, is they like to sneak provisions notwithstanding in other sections of the contract. And it might say your use or operations clause says you have to stay open and you can't be closed for more than 30 days, even if you're in force majeure. It won't be in the force majeure clause, it'll be stuck somewhere else. That's why we don't like brokers negotiating leases, because they don't know to look for stuff like that. And they're not lawyers most of the time. One of the big things in a force majeure clause is the person claiming force majeure has to tell the other side, hey, I'm in force majeure. We have to give written notice. We're in a force majeure situation, so sorry. We're not going to be paying rent. We're not going to be building a restaurant. We're not going to be doing X, Y, Z, in order to trigger the protections of that clause. Now, that is becoming, post-COVID, it is much more likely that you will see this, because during COVID, a lot of tenants said, we're in force majeure and we don't have to tell you. We didn't have to tell you when it started. We didn't have to tell you when we went into force majeure. We just are there now, and so we're not going to do X, Y, and Z. And so I would say this requirement was probably in 50% of the force majeure clauses before, and I bet it's in 90% of the force majeure clauses now. So it's a pretty big difference. And then the inapplicability of a force majeure clause to the payment of money, which has now been expanded to financial inability, financial incapacity, shortage of funds, because a lot of time when you don't have that clause, the person claiming force majeure can say the shortage of funds is a force majeure, not I have shortage of funds because of a force majeure. The unexpected eventuality is I don't have money and therefore I'm not going to pay you. I actually like that. I wish that was in more of them, but they're not, because of savvy landlord drafting, and I understand why. So the post-COVID landlord force majeure clause, these are taken from actual leases that we've dealt with, and so they're highlighted here. Rather than just put them into a paper for you guys to download, I just put them here in one place, and then what we also will see a little bit is sort of my firm's drafting against some of these landlord provisions, which I think are actually pretty fair, and I recommend that if you take them and make them better, please let me know. If you take them and use them, I wish you the best. So now we're going to see the specific inclusion of the words epidemic and pandemic in these force majeure clauses. They were probably in 10% of the force majeure clauses pre-COVID, and that's because of bird flu. They weren't really there before that, because between Spanish flu and bird flu, nobody really worried about a pandemic or an epidemic, and now you see them there. So you will see that, but the yellow provision, so I don't know, let's look at that. Your typical force majeure is strikes, lockouts, labor troubles, that's always been there. Inability to procure materials, that's lumber, electrical powers, things like that. Restrictive governmental laws or regulations, now that we saw a lot of in COVID, more to come on that later. And so the yellow section is a qualifier. It is understood that the provisions of the force majeure clause do not excuse the payment of rent or any other dollars. Great. And then a specifically new section in red, kind of hard to see, it's a little dark up here, but it says, it is understood that a party's financial inability to perform shall not be deemed to excuse non-performance or delayed performance. Now, in the litigation that we just concluded about a 2020 lockout during COVID, the force majeure clause had no restrictions, it was completely open-ended, and it said if the performance of the tenant is hindered or prevented, it was completely and totally broad and open-ended, and it still didn't save the tenant. So I really thought I would be giving a different talk in May of 2023, having won that trial in April of 2023, that we would have different result to talk about. But when the plaintiff's counsel writes an article that says an unrestricted force majeure clause is a get-out-of-jail-free card for the tenant, you tend to be rather confident about your chances, but sometimes it doesn't work out that way. So when we saw COVID restrictions from all 50 governments of the United States of America, what we saw in some way, shape, or form was restrictions on restaurants and salons and other types of service businesses being able to be open in one capacity or another, whether completely open or partially open. And for, at least for restaurants in Texas and many other states, that meant in the early days of 2020, we were not allowed to be open at all in our dining rooms for a little while, and they were completely closed with no to-go, no delivery, no whatever. After a couple of weeks, restaurants are able to sell to-go and pickup and delivery only, right? So that means dining rooms not able to be open, but other ways to make money were available. Now, in the economics of a restaurant company, that doesn't necessarily work, because you have to have basically all the labor, you have to have basically all the product. You can't, your product probably, if you buy a really good hamburger and fries, the distance that can travel and still be a quality product is not that far. And so you have brand degradation, you have all of the ripple effects of the government closure of your dining room that are not macroeconomic, they're microeconomic in that they're not direct damages to you. You can't put them necessarily on a spreadsheet because a lot of them are just intangible. And so we had clients who did not open even though they were able to open for to-go and delivery, because they either didn't have the infrastructure, they didn't want to pay war profiteering to the third-party delivery services, they put all their employees into the unemployment system because they were making more on unemployment than they were in the restaurants. There were myriad reasons for doing that. And so the governmental restrictions that closed the dining rooms did not do them any favors, unless they were sort of the pizza, fast food, drive-through, Asian food, things that already either had a delivery infrastructure or that had the ability to get people there on social media. And so practically everyone was in a force majeure situation. I mean, 99% of the people, unless you were a Jack in the Box. Jack in the Box, I think last year I said their stock price went from $19 to $120 in a year, from March of 20 to March of 21. They did okay. Mom and pops, hair salons, things like that, tanning salons, they couldn't work. And so the addition that we have added now is, if any portion of your business is affected by a governmental restriction, this clause is going to kick in, because the landlords do not understand the economics of their tenant's business. They only know rent, pass-through expenses, things that hit the spreadsheet that make a bottom line. And I'm not ignorant to the fact that landlords have notes to pay, landlords need to make money, but when the system, if the system breaks down on one half of the system, the other half of the system is going to also break down, so there has to be a way to find common ground, which we'll get to in a second. So our goal now is to negotiate if there is any government closure, we're going to find a solution that we try to work, that we try to work for both sides. So here, if we get a government shutdown and it prohibits the tenant from operating 50% of the premises, we get a 50% abatement of gross rent. It's not my favorite clause. It's just a clause. The 50% reduction relative to the 50% of square footage that you can't use is not a dollar for dollar recovery of benefit, but it's better than nothing, and it's a good starting place, and if it's all you can get, it's better than not getting anything. So here's why landlords are bad. I mean, it's not the only reason. This is just the reason that's on this slide. There's like five reasons on this slide. So this is a provision from a very aggressive, very wealthy landowner that owns properties all over the country, and this is what they were putting out immediately post-COVID. So notwithstanding our force majeure clause, which was already bad, if a force majeure event is a governmentally required, see that red word, complete closure of all similar business establishment, whatever that means, in the applicable jurisdiction, and is not covered in whole or part by government relief, well, let's talk about why that's bad, because at least in 2020, government relief didn't kick in for months. It also changed its character multiple times, right? So government relief wasn't necessarily government relief. If you think back to late 2020, early 2021, when landlords heard that PPP money could be used to pay rent, they heard shall be used to pay rent. 100% of them. And so we had landlords that said, we will give you abatement of rent if you provide to us the amount of a copy of your PPP loan application. We want to know how much you got for PPP, and we want to know how you're spending your PPP, including the 40% that's coming to us. PPP was not necessarily to pay landlords. It was to pay employees. And so if it's not covered in whole or part by government relief, doesn't help us, because in the next pandemic, in the next crisis, I promise you the government relief is not going to look like $1.5 trillion of printing money. Because there are now, talk about ripple effects, there are ripple effects from the 2020-2021 COVID relief that we are just now seeing in all this inflationary situation that we're in now. And so this is drafted based on a very specific set of COVID-related government relief that we probably won't see. And we have so your tenant is going to be languishing in a non-force majeure situation, waiting on the government for months to declare some sort of relief that may not come. And so they may or may not be in force majeure, because if the government then turns on the spigots of relief, you come out of force majeure, but you might not get the money for 9 months, just like happened in 2021. So this is just not, it's just not good. It's just not well done. It's embarrassing. And also, so you see, after the second black line, if it's not covered by tenant business interruption insurance, well, landlords really quickly got into the business of evaluating tenants' insurance policies and not understanding anything that was in there about virus exclusions, pandemic exclusions, because speaking of bird flu, 99.9% of the insurance policies out there exclude pandemics and epidemics because they drafted around bird flu back in the early, in the mid-2000s, and that's been boilerplate for over 10 years. And so business interruption insurance was not a factor. So rent doesn't abate for the first 30 days. That's gracious. So you still get to pay rent even though you're not opening, even if there's a shutdown, because I guess they expect you to pay all the money that's in the cash register in the bank account just, and you know, until that 30-day period is over, so that's kind. And if the government mandated shutdown persists for more than 30 consecutive days, and here's my favorite sentence, the tenant demonstrates to the landlord's reasonable satisfaction that their gross receipts have reduced 25% or more. So we love doing things subject to the landlord's reasonable satisfaction because they're not reasonable and they're never satisfied. I might put that on a plaque or something. It's just true. I just take it to the bank. Let's write it on a tablet. I think we can agree. So we're going to abate the force majeure. We're going to go into a reduction of by percentages, which I already said we don't like, until the earlier of the date on which the tenant reopens for business, because they'll be so awash in cash they can start paying rent that day. That's good. Or 120 days following the shutdown, whichever is earlier. So if it takes you 120 days to ramp back up because you have no money and you have no employees, you still get to pay rent 120 days after the shutdown ends. Thank you so much. So here is our sort of counter to that. And this, we're pretty proud of this because we started using this in 2021 because, believe it or not, there were a lot of people sitting on the sidelines that were washing cash that started doing deals in mid-2021 and acquiring properties and replacing tenants, and there was a pretty vibrant real estate practice in 2021, early 2022, because there were deals to be made. And so so we've gotten this into leases all over the country. And again, it isn't perfect, but it's I think it's better than not having it. So in the event the tenant is prohibited from fully operating in the red language entire premises, right? And premises is a capital P definition that changes based on the lease. It could include the parking lot, it could include the common area, it could include the entire shopping center. Well, it's not gonna be the shopping center, but it could be the patio. It could include the patio, it could include the dining room, it could include the parking lot. And so, depending on what your definition of capital P premises is, this might help you or more than it would if it was just the envelope of the building itself. So, if we're shut down by a governmental order restricting occupancy to less than 50% of full occupancy, which 100% did happen in Texas for a very long period of time, adopted by a governmental authority in connection with COVID or anything similar, then tenant pays the lesser of, that's important, minimum rent, which is rent, usually rent without triple nets, common area maintenance, pass-through expenses. Minimum rent is the rent that is the rent you think you're paying when you sign the lease without all the extra charges that go up every year. And so we want to keep it to that. So they pay minimum rent or alternate rent, which is in the next paragraph, which is gross sales multiplied by 10%. 10% of gross sales, whatever sales we make. We open the drive-thru and we only make $1,000, we're gonna pay 10% of that. So, we've gotten that accepted by numerous landlords, and I'm pretty happy about it, because if this catastrophic pandemic situation raises its head again, then we have to have a way for tenants to stay open and want to stay open and try to make the money that they can make and not worry that they're gonna have to pay full rent, full triple nets, full common area. And triple nets is when they pass through, landlord pass through, insurance, property taxes, all the things they can pass through. I said, it's good to be the king, right? You can pass through all those expenses. But if they know that they have a 10% of gross sales VIG to pay to the landlord, they're more likely to operate than to throw up their hands and say, we're just gonna put everybody into unemployment. So, here's what we want to think about for drafting. There is often a definition of casualty in other sections of the lease where it talks about what happens when the building burns down or get knocked down by a hurricane. If casualty includes the definition of an epidemic or a pandemic, then we have to contract around the definition of casualty when we're drafting our force majeure clause. If it's snuck into the casualty provision, we don't address it, then they'll trigger the casualty and not the force majeure, and we'll be screwed. So carve out the specific exceptions for any governmental restrictions like we talked about, and whether that, I mean, if you have 100 seats on the patio and you want to keep your patio open, you should be able to do that. But if the dining room is closed, you may not have a patio. I mean, patio is king now. People love the idea of having patios because if we have another pandemic, they're going to want to put a lot of diners outside. But not everybody has that option. So carve out your exceptions for governmental restrictions that allow you to be open and that allow you to pay less rent if possible. If there are carve-outs related to government assistance, like we talked about before, make sure those are limited. They don't kick in until some period of time after the government assistance is announced, because if the program is announced by the government, but it doesn't get implemented for 120 days, then when does it affect your force majeure clause? When Congress passes it, or when it actually becomes available to the tenant in the form of money, right? It should get triggered when the tenant gets the assistance, if ever. They may not even qualify. Some of the programs ran out of money. PPP ran out of money. And so just because it's available, you might not qualify. Another thing related to, just as an aside, as we look at economic activity in 2023 and beyond, for our clients that took EIDL money, Economic Incentive Disaster Loan money, as one of the government programs, it was an SBA program. It's a 3% loan, 30-year term, cheap government cheese. Everyone took it. When they took it, they gave the SBA a lien on all of their assets. And so they have a first position on everyone's assets. And now we're seeing a lot of M&A activity that where people are forgetting that the SBA has a first position. And so when acquisition is happening with debt, they have the SBA to deal with. And guess who's not fast? The SBA's not fast. People want to close fast. Everybody wants to close at the end of the quarter. Everybody wants to close at the end of the month. Some people want to close in September. I love those people. Those are not the people that we deal with all the time. Everybody who wants to close fast forgets that they have to deal with the SBA's first position on the assets. So if you're refinancing, if you're doing things involving somebody with an EIDL loan, which is just about everybody, you have to take that into account, just as an aside. It's been coming up a lot in the last 2 or 3 months. If the force majeure clause requires a notice requirement, let's try to get the issuance of the government order itself to be noticed. That way, the tenant who is closed by the government doesn't have to find a way to go into that business, go to their office, find letterhead. See, because when I do leases, I take email out of notice. I do not want email as notice. It's too unreliable. We get thousands of emails. And so if they're not in the business, they're not sitting at they don't have their postage machine, they don't whatever, they're going to be panicking about the closure of their business. They're not necessarily going to go and put together a one-pager that says, I think this pandemic just put me into force majeure. So if the government issues an order, GA08 in Texas was Governor Abbott's executive order number 8 of 2020, it closed dining rooms, that should be our notice. And I'm particularly proud of this one because I think it's a super cool idea. So common area maintenance is what the landlord will pass through to keep up things like fountains and gardens and elevators and parking lots and lighting and all kinds of the things outside the envelope of the premises, and try to get those curtailed as well, because guess who's going to be closed? The shopping center, the building. But even though if the building is closed and not operating, that doesn't stop the landlord from charging the tenant pass-through expenses. And so if the shopping center is closed, the tenant shouldn't be paying us. Okay, so we want to look at the casualty definition. We want to look at if you have negotiated a lease and you're in the middle of build out and you haven't gotten into a rent commencement date yet, and then the pandemic happens, you may never get your business open. And so the rent commencement date or the lease commencement date also needs to be thought about in terms of force majeure. What does the force majeure do to the date that you have to be open by? Does it get moved? Because typically the force majeure clause is going to be really general and say the deadlines are going to get moved by the same number of days as the force majeure event. But if you've never gotten open, you don't owe anybody any rent yet, we can negotiate what happens to the rent commencement, because if the city offices can't process your building permit application, then you may never get there. And so what we also saw was a 1,000% increase in construction costs. And so people are going to start bailing if they don't have a path to getting open. They're just going to start breaking these leases and walking. Landlord work letters, which is a letter in the lease or a section of the lease, usually as an exhibit that says what the landlord has to do, those should be affected as well. But beyond leases, we have our construction contracts, the contracts with our general contractors, purchase and sale agreements when we're buying and selling businesses, vendor contracts. These all need to have similar force majeure provisions, because if it's good for a lease, it's good for a purchase and sale agreement. I mean, it's going to be boilerplate in a lot of these unless we change it and make it not boilerplate. And think about contracts, catering contracts, catering, room rental, special event contracts that aren't normally the kind that feature a force majeure clause. Think about putting those in there, especially with regard to pandemic, because as the hotel folks here know, we're still booking weddings in 2023 that should have happened in 2020. And it would be great to have that addressed with a force majeure clause, so because it caused a lot of, I say, customer dissatisfaction. And that's an angry ferret. Just so you know, no one really has ever seen an angry ferret, and we're changing the name of my firm to ferretlaw.com, because all the other good animals are taken, tigers and lions and law eagle and all this other stuff. So I'm just kidding, but I do own the domain, but I haven't done anything with it yet. But the idea of an angry ferret, I mean, who, you know, you can't get away from them. So anyway, ferretlaw.com, it's coming next year, maybe next year. Fair.
Any questions for David? Da, 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 da. Okay, well, it's a couple of things. They tell me it's warmer in here. All right, let's take a quick poll. Who thinks it's warmer? Raise your hand. Who says, hell no, it's still freezing? Okay, I'm working on it still. I know, I'm cold too, but I'm kind of a weenie. All right, it's break time. We're running just a little behind, so I want to give you the full time. So we're going to come back at 11:40, which is about 17 minutes from now. Ladies, there are restrooms here on this floor, but I know there aren't that many. As a free tip, if you go down to the third floor,